Welcome back. So I'm very pleased to have Ryan Adams here, who is an assistant professor at Harvard University, and he will be talking about nonparametric Bayes. Yeah, so welcome.
Thanks. Okay, so I'm going to talk about Bayesian nonparametrics. Now, Gaussian processes are Bayesian nonparametric models, but I'm going to sort of like talk about the complement in some sense of Bayesian nonparametrics. But I'll try to tie it back to some of the things that Neil talked about when appropriate and try to talk about how both of these things are sort of interesting infinite dimensional views on machine learning. Before I get started, I want to sort of just point out that a lot of this material leans heavily on past tutorials in Bayesian nonparametrics, in particular by EYT and also some work by Zubin Garamani. And I didn't want to, you know, reinvent the wheel in terms of talking about some of these ideas. So much like Neil, it turns out you have to plug this in first for it to work. Much like Neil, I'm going to start out by sort of motivating this from kind of a high level with, you know, talking about kind of Bayesian machine learning and the motivations for Bayesian machine learning, and then kind of talk about how that relates to, you know, why we would care about nonparametric models in that worldview. So machine learning these days is all about data. I mean, it kind of has its roots in AI, but we spend a lot of time thinking about how to model data to various degrees now. And you know, data is hard in a lot of different ways. It can be complicated and stochastic, and you can have sort of noisy observations, or you can have partial observations, and so on. And you know, probability theory is not all machine learning is probabilistic, but probability theory gives us a very rich toolbox for thinking about a lot of the sort of, you know, the challenges of things like partial observations and noise and so on. And a lot of the kind of the framework we're going to be talking about today has to do with probabilistic graphical models specifically, which are kind of a really nice way to think about building big complicated probability distributions, including nonparametric distributions. You know, there's a lot of reasons we like things like probabilistic graphical models. We like them because they give us an intuitive way to use, you know, lines and circles and things to describe complicated phenomena. You know, it's a visualization tool. They highlight the modularity that we often get when building probabilistic models, where you can take a piece, you know, one kind of piece and build that in as a subcomponent of another piece, and this is often reflected in probabilistic graphical structure. We like that the graphs that we get often reveal interesting structure that we can take advantage of when building inference algorithms and fitting procedures. And one of the things I really like about the sort of the probabilistic modeling view and the kind of the Bayesian worldview, and I think this was also well captured by, I imagine, you know, Bob talked about this and Neil definitely just talked about it, which is the idea of separating out modeling concerns and assumptions that we're going to make about the world, so our kind of inductive bias, separating those from the algorithms that we're then going to use to fit the data. Now, that's not to say that we don't often make assumptions about modeling that are going to lead to nice computational properties, and that's something that comes up a lot in Bayesian nonparametrics, but kind of one of the things we like about building probabilistic models and graphical models is precisely the idea we can kind of uncouple these things, that we can come up with the model that we'd like to have and make our assumptions, and then figuring out how to turn the crank on that or approximate it in some interesting way can then be kind of a separate discussion, that we're not conflating sort of the algorithmic ideas with the modeling assumptions. All right, so this is kind of some of the things we like about Bayesian modeling. Broadly speaking, we tend to think about kind of observed data and latent variables, and we have some sort of set of parameters that are going to couple those observed data and those latent the observed variables and the latent variables. And a probabilistic model of the kind we're talking about here is going to be essentially just a joint distribution over stuff we can see and stuff we can't see in terms of some parameters that we're going to try to fit to our data. A lot of times we like to talk about generative models specifically, where in some sense the sort of latent variables have a distribution that arises from some set of the theta parameters, and then the observed data that we see are generated based, you know, in some interesting way based on those latent variables. And this is kind of a nice way to view the world, because if the latent variables reflect things of, say, scientific interest or provide some visualization or interpretability, then we can do, you know, we can compute the posterior distribution of those latent variables straightforwardly just by applying the product rule of probability or Bayes theorem, right? So this is kind of a nice and coherent way to reason about latent structure in data. Often then we are tasked with the problem of trying to fit the actual parameters, something we can do with something like, you know, maximum likelihood or map inference, or we can try to integrate everything out. In any case, what we typically try to do is find some some set of parameters that make the data happiest marginally, taking into account all settings of these latent variables. The cool thing about this, yep. Oh, that implies a mistake on my part. This should be a comma right here. No, sorry, just kidding. It should be a comma here. Yeah, that's a mistake. Thank you. I invented a new thing, the double conditional. So one of the other things, we also, after we fit parameters, we like to be able to also think about how to make predictions. This is something we can very coherently do kind of by talking about the distribution over both the latent variables and the observed variables for some new thing. Broadly speaking, we can use these kinds of ideas in a lot of different ways, from visualization to making sort of interpretable latent variable models, summarizing our data, helping us make decisions, doing lots of different things. This business of fitting the parameters and doing this inference can sometimes be easy, but it's often hard, and there's a large toolbox of computational tools for trying to solve these problems. Things, you know, classic ideas like EM for, you know, augmenting, for sort of imputing hidden variables in order to do maximum likelihood, to sort of other kinds of powerful ideas like variational inference and MCMC. We're not going to talk too much about that today. We're going to kind of focus on the modeling side of things and just hint around at some of the inference procedures that we need to use. The name of the game, broadly speaking, from a pure Bayesian point of view, is going to be to come up with some prior distribution over these parameters that we care about, and then we can use inference now to not just find sort of the distribution over latent variables, but also now do that, you know, use it to perform the learning itself, to actually, so that is to say, instead of just focusing on Bayesian inference for the y's, we can also use them for the thetas and actually then reason about uncertainty in the model that we're trying to fit. And we can do this really cool thing, which is make predictions integrating out everything. So making predictions about new data, maybe making classifications and so on, that are not just integrating out the latent y's, the latent variables, but also integrating out uncertainty in the thetas due to the posterior induced by sort of previous things we've seen. So there's a lot of different things we like about this. One of them is this graphical structure that we can often build to reason about things like medical diagnoses. This is a Bayesian network or a directed probabilistic graphical model in which the nodes in the graph represent random variables. The edges represent different kinds of dependencies, and in particular, they represent conditional distributions. And the idea is now that lack of edges gives us interesting information about how this distribution might factor. And this not only helps us reason about sort of, as I said, you know, dependency and modularity, but also helps us build efficient algorithms for reasoning about these kinds of things. There's a few different kinds of examples that I'm going to use as kind of running examples for talking about Bayesian nonparametrics specifically. I think the go-to model that we talk about a lot is what we think of as model-based clustering. All right, so this is, so rather than a clustering algorithm like k-means that is sort of like this kind of defining a loss function in terms of some notion of grouping or reconstruction, model-based clustering is writing down a generative model that produces our data, or that could produce our data a priori, given latent indices that indicate what class they belong to. Okay, so typically we can think of this as being the idea that our data that we're trying to model are in some sense heterogeneous, coming from a few different kinds of sources, okay? This kind of picture is the thing we usually encounter, where we have like three different groups, and the groups maybe have different shapes and different sizes, and we're trying to discover the properties of those clusters, and also trying to discover the sort of the membership of the data themselves. All right, so a typical thing to do in a model-based clustering, like we would do in the Bayesian world, is we would come up with some mixture weights over the different membership probabilities. Say in this case, you know, k is the number of clusters here. We'd say k equals 3, and then every one of those clusters is going to own something like a Gaussian distribution that produces the actual observations given that latent assignment. Okay, so the graphical model for this kind of thing typically looks like this, where we have some hyperprior on a set of mixture weights. They're sort of governing how big those guys are in terms of what proportion of the data they own. Then this plate notation indicates sort of conditional independence given those parameters. There's some latent identity that we can't see that is going to be 1, 2, or 3. and then the actual observations that we get, which also depend on the parameters associated with each of those three clusters, and those parameters also have some high-level prior. I'm going to use this kind of, even though I'm talking about kind of a classic mixture model here, I'm going to go in and start out using this this kind of a little bit unusual notation, H and alpha. And we'll talk a little bit more about why that is. Think of H in general today as being the the prior associated with some set of parameters in our sort of like clustering model. And alpha, you want to think of as governing something like a Dirichlet distribution. Okay, so in this particular setup, what we're saying is there's k possible clusters. They're going to have weights, so this vector pi is sort of k-dimensional, non-negative sums to one. We're going to put a Dirichlet distribution on it with some parameter alpha. And here what I'm doing is indicating that we're using what we call kind of a symmetric Dirichlet distribution. So all of the alphas for every parameter are the same, and we're sort of dividing them by k, by the total number of outcomes. Then once you get an assignment, then I'm saying, as I said before, or not once you get an assignment, but once you've created a cluster, then the parameters are coming from this distribution H. Question? Closeness in the statistical sense. So really what we're saying here is that given the parameters of the model and given some datum, then I can infer which cluster you belong to basically using Bayesian inference on those latent variables, right? So am I well explained? If I'm some point, am I well explained by this guy, or this guy? It's literally likelihood modulated by pi, which is what Bayes' theorem is, right? It's the likelihood multiplied by that prior. Okay, we'll spend some more time on this, but I guess just sort of taking a minute, is this notation something you guys are pretty happy with? Yeah? We're kind of on the same page with this notation? Tildes and things like that? Okay? Yep? Lowercase n. So I'm going to be using lowercase n to index over data, which often people use lowercase I to index over data, and I don't like to do that because I like to index over things little, the lowercase version indexing up to the big version. So then when you see something sub n, you know that there are big n number of them. Sub d, you see big n, big d number of them. And this is in contrast to sort of statistics literature, which uses lowercase n and lowercase p and then indexes with I, but I could index anything as a dummy variable. So I don't like that. So if you see a lowercase something, you can assume there's like in its indexing, the number of those is the uppercase version. Okay, so sub n just means number of data here. Or sorry, so large n is the number of data, little n is indexing each one of them. Okay? All right, so clustering models are one example of sort of probabilistic graphical models, the latent variables that we care about. Another kind of classic example is the idea of a hidden Markov model. So this is where we have some time series, things are ticking along, there's observations that we can see. These observations are conditionally independent given some latent, say, discrete state that is also ticking along according to some Markov dynamics, right? And those Markov dynamics are determined by a set of pi's that is kind of, are you going from state 1 to state 6 and so on? And then every one of those states also has a set of parameters to govern it, again, with alpha and h being the priors for those guys. Now, this is also a kind of model that we could use. We could have a very similar looking model that would tie back to Gaussian processes, where this could be something like a Kalman filter that Neil mentioned. Okay, so this is just another example of using latent variables to induce structure in data. There's lots of other things too, you probably encountered things like latent Dirichlet allocation, also things like collaborative filtering, where we're imagining that we have some, there's a bunch of people that have rated some movies or products or something, and there are latent properties of each one of both the movies and the people. And you could imagine, for example, parameterizing their ratings using like the inner product between those latent features. Okay, so this is a common way to think about like recommendation systems and so on. But it's just another example of a latent variable model that we could frame in terms of a big joint probability distribution. Okay, so now let's talk about nonparametrics. So that's kind of the broad Bayesian view on like why we like to use probability and why we like to use latent variables. It lets us kind of induce structure while having relatively simple local dependencies. So nonparametrics, so at a high level, all nonparametric means is at some level they just have like a really big parametric model. It's kind of weird, right? Because nonparametric sounds like it should mean that there are no parameters, but what it really should be is something like massively parametric, right? So it's not that there are no parameters, it's that there are a huge number of parameters, all right? So, and when we sort of formalize this in the Bayesian nonparametric and also the sort of frequentist nonparametric setting, what that means basically is that actually the number of parameters that you have in the model is essentially growing with the number of data. Okay, and so if you think about like what Neil was talking about, where the kind of the number of affected basis functions is growing as you get more data, it's the same idea, right? So that the sort of weights on those basis functions are parameters, and as we get more data, then we can sort of accommodate more of these weights. And we'll see this again in the context of like the Dirichlet process and Indian Buffet process and so on. More generally, when we think about sort of non-parametric models, it's kind of useful to think about it as being sort of dense in a very large space that's relevant to some problem we care about. So what I mean by that is that, you know, you can imagine a very large space of possible models, some kind of like true model, if you will. And the idea basically is that, you know, simple parametric models can be small and occupy some region of space where we're trying to kind of get as close to this F star as we can. Maybe we can make them bigger by adding more parameters. But the idea is that rather than this kind of restriction bias, right, rather than an inductive bias that's specified through restriction, what we can do is instead come up with a kind of a soft global bias, okay? And the idea essentially is to order these hypotheses about the way that the world works, but allow them to occupy a very, very large proportion of this of the possible space of hypotheses. Okay, so that is to say, so Gaussian process is a great example of this in the sense that, you know, there's some true function out there that's something kind of complicated, but something like, I don't know, let's say the Ornstein-Uhlenbeck kernel, you know, that allows you to model a very, very, very large class of continuous functions, many of which will be arbitrarily close to the thing that's the truth. Okay, so that's what we kind of mean by dense, is that contains tons and tons and tons and tons of functions, and some of those are going to be very near almost anything you might ever want to model. Right? So that's kind of the essence of a nonparametric model. And it, you know, we were having a little bit of a discussion kind of like an hour ago about kind of whether or not, for example, neural networks are, you know, deep learning is sort of in this space. And I kind of think the answer is yes, because you're talking about massively parametric models that are dense in an interestingly large space. I mean, deep learning is adaptive basis function regression. It contains a lot of functions, right? And so so I tend to think of them as being something very close to a nonparametric model, but opinions on that differ. Okay, so part of the motivation here as well, in addition to sort of reasoning about kind of big, complicated, dense spaces, is also as a kind of way to sidestep certain kinds of like model selection issues. So often if you come up with a mixture model or you come up with some interesting probabilistic language model or whatever it is, you're faced with trying to choose some order essentially for this model. There's some high level kind of choices, number of clusters, number of topics, so on. Selecting those sort of the number of clusters is one of the toughest things to sort of do in machine learning, right? Selecting the number of polynomials in your basis or whatever often demands things like cross-validation, or if you're being fully Bayesian, computing some possibly very expensive marginal likelihood, and then enumerating possible models, right, that sort of might contend for being the best model. In general, either selecting or averaging over such, you know, over models can be something that's very expensive, right? It involves maybe fitting that model completely, multiple times even, and then having some kind of quantitative sort of way that you trust to compare these different things. This is totally critical, right? Because this is the only way we kind of avoid overfitting and underfitting in big machine learning models, is by doing something like cross-validation or evaluating the marginal likelihood. Now, ideally, if you're sort of a well-specified Bayesian, then you don't overfit, right? Because you're marginalizing out your parameters, you're trying to account for your uncertainty. Now, it may be that you're making crappy predictions because you've identified an enormous flexible model class and have not put any sort of interesting, sort of strong inductive bias on your space, but you won't overfit as such. On the other hand, you can definitely underfit with a Bayesian model. You can come up with a model that simply doesn't have enough capacity to model the things you care about. It's like, you know, if you use a linear function for quadratic data, right? You can be a well-specified Bayesian, handle that all very well, but you can still, you still don't have support for quadratic functions. And so the idea with Bayesian nonparametrics is by being dense in the space of possible functions or possible sort of random measures, as we'll talk about today, the idea is to be able to really accommodate a tremendous number of interestingly complex models and be able to reason about those as the data warrant it, but still without hopefully underfitting. Okay? So it's trying to sort of have your cake and eat it too, if you will. So when we talk about kind of large function spaces, I mean, we've seen, you know, Neil talked about a lot of things like Gaussian processes, where a large function space corresponds to having very, very many interesting, sort of interesting functions that you can use for regression. We're going to focus today on, you know, at least in the beginning, on kind of other kinds of objects, in particular things like Dirichlet process mixture models that are in some sense dense in the space of densities. Okay, so we're going to be coming up with distributions over other distributions. That's going to be the name of the game. And we'll talk about other kinds of objects that you can create using very similar ideas. So, and then finally, kind of one of the things we like relative to sort of pure model selection is being able to use these kinds of ideas to come up with flexible, say, sort of combinatorial discrete type structures to reason about dependencies in sort of more direct ways by using priors rather than doing searches over model space. So things like, say, coming up with priors over random acyclic directed graphs and things like trees and so on. Okay, so this is all sort of part of the motivation for thinking about these flexible model spaces. Finally, there's some really nice properties that we'll talk only a little bit today, but that have to do with kind of coherent reasoning in very large, you know, in difficult sort of probabilistic modeling settings, ideas like projectivity and exchangeability, which we'll come back to, but also interesting ways that we can achieve things like power laws and so on within this kind of modular framework where we can take one interesting idea like a Dirichlet process or a Pittman-Yor process or something like that and plug it into a larger topic model or some, you know, HMM and so on. Okay, so as I said, nonparametric, you know, is kind of a weird name for this kind of thing, is it doesn't really mean no parameters. What it means is that it kind of can't be described by a single fixed set of parameters. Like I said, I really like to think of it as massively parametric and not parameter-free as such. But the fact that we are sort of dense in this large space, or the fact that we maybe don't have to commit ourselves to some particular finite basis, right, in the case of Gaussian processes, it doesn't mean that we don't have to make assumptions, right? So every one of those kernels, sort of non-degenerate kernels that Neil talked about, right? Every one of those was infinite dimensional, right? So whether you're talking about that, you know, exponentiated quadratic or the Materin 3.5 or whether you're talking about Ornstein-Uhlenbeck or the neural network kernel and so on, every one of those actually expands to an infinite basis, right? But they still make different assumptions. Right, they still correspond to different sort of biases about the way that the world works, some, you know, corresponding to interesting non-stationarities or stationarities or differentiability and so on. So the fact that we're going to be very flexible doesn't cause us to not have to make assumptions about the world. The point is that these assumptions can, in some sense, be weaker or more general, right? So again, in the Gaussian process case, rather than saying I'm going to use up to cubic polynomials to model my data, I can just say, I think things should be, you know, twice differentiable. Something like that, all right? So we can hopefully be a little bit more flexible. And then also the idea is that we can use these kind of flexible models within larger parametric models because of this modularity, particularly to deal with sort of like interesting, you know, not interesting, or rather uninteresting nuisance type things that are going on in the data to help us focus on the interpretable parameters we care about. And this is something we think of as being like semi-parametric modeling. We won't talk about that today, but it's something you can do through this kind of nice flexibility and modularity. The problem is, you know, it's hard and it's sort of incomplete. It's an active research area. Often a lot of these things are not necessarily models you'll just be able to like pop out of the box and go to work with, although, you know, folks like Bob are developing, you know, amazing probabilistic programming tools to make this easier and easier. Nevertheless, it can be challenging to come up with priors that match, you know, nonparametric priors are going to match your beliefs about the world. And a lot of the inference algorithms that we encounter in practice are not yet scalable to really interestingly large data sets. The theoretical understanding is progressing, but it's a little bit, you know, it's underdeveloped relative to some other areas of statistics and machine learning, in particular, like sort of asymptotics and things that Bayesians had taken for granted are a little bit more challenging in the non-parametric setting. We won't talk too much about what that, you know, what that means, but the point is that this is something that people are still thinking about and still trying to completely understand kind of when these things work and when they don't. The good news is there's a lot of resources out there for learning about these ideas. You know, there's some excellent video lectures from previous machine learning summer schools and from major conferences. There's some nice review articles that have been coming out, both kind of things at a high level, but also for some specific topics we'll talk about, as well as a book that came out a couple of years ago. But it's a rapidly moving field, so a lot of these things sort of become out of date relatively quickly. Okay, questions about high level stuff, you know, kind of motivation and so on before we dive into some of the more nitty-gritty. Okay, so we're going to start talking about the Dirichlet process via sort of what we call taking the limit of a finite mixture model, which is not correct, but it's a very nice intuitive way to do it. And it's kind of how the field of machine learning kind of started to encounter a lot of these ideas, was by deriving things kind of the wrong way and then discovering that actually it still works. And then trying to figure out the right way to do it. The basis for thinking about the Dirichlet process will not surprise you too much. It's going to be thinking about the Dirichlet distribution. Dirichlet distribution is something that everybody is already super familiar with, not too familiar with. Raise your hand if it's like old hat to think about the Dirichlet distribution. Okay. Oh, no, that's good. It's good. Okay, so Dirichlet distribution is a little bit funky. So how about the beta distribution? Okay, so the beta distribution, right, is you think of it as a like a prior for coin flips, right? So you get a random number between 0 and 1 that you can imagine as a really nice model for Bernoulli outcomes. Dirichlet distribution is just the like, it's just for k greater than 2. It's like the beta distribution for more than 2 outcomes, okay? So it's the prior on dice instead. So it's kind of a couple different ways to think about it. Like I said, it's a little bit funny because it's a distribution over discrete distributions. Okay, so we can think about it as producing random numbers in the simplex, right? So for example, if we had a three-sided die, which I guess you probably can't have, but then we could think about this is not a three-sided die. This is visualizing three different outcomes. Then we can think about how it might put distributions on how weighted each of those three sides are. I really like this, which is off of Wikipedia, which is sort of said these are draws from a Dirichlet distribution, okay? So we take one Dirichlet distribution with some parameters, okay? And then different draws are going to produce random distributions over three outcomes, okay? So my PhD advisor used to say it like this. He would say that, okay, so we're used to having dice, but a Dirichlet distribution is like a crappy dice factory. Okay, so what it does is it produces dice that have some mean, but that every one it produces a little bit different with a different little bit of a different bias, and that bias is characterized in some way, or variance, and that variance is characterized in some way. Okay, so it's a distribution over discrete distributions. Here's its probability density function, which has these terrifying gamma functions in it, but don't worry about it. That's just a normalization constant. It is parameterized by k positive numbers that don't necessarily have to sum to 1, which are the alphas we're going to use here. What's really nice about the Dirichlet distribution is that it's conjugate to the multinomial distribution. So if I start with a prior on some distribution, on some discrete distribution that has a Dirichlet form, and then I get a bunch of counts that arise from this unknown distribution, then the posterior distribution is also Dirichlet. This is super easy because all you have to do is basically add the counts from each of the outcomes to the alphas, and that's your new set of alphas for this new distribution. Okay, so you can just keep track of counts, then you can interpret those initial alphas. You can interpret your prior as sort of the counts that were there before you saw any actual data, so your pseudo counts that sort of specify your a priori beliefs about this distribution. It also has a very nice property that you can marginalize away the pi's. So you can marginalize away the actual distribution you're trying to model and just get a marginal likelihood that is sort of probability of a particular set of multinomial counts in terms of these Dirichlet parameters alpha. This distribution has a name. It's called the Dirichlet multinomial distribution. It's like not super exciting, but it's just like the Dirichlet times a multinomial integrating out the parameters. And it's a complicated joint distribution now on the counts. So the conditional independence goes away by integrating out the pies. It also has this really cool thing, which is it has a closed form predictive distribution. So you see a bunch of counts you see a bunch of outcomes from this multinomial that has parameters you don't know. You can compute the predictive distribution, so you can compute the probability that you're going to get a particular count in the next sort of like roll of this die, and taking into account all possible actual biases of that die. And it has a really simple form, which is basically the number of times you've seen it come up, you know, say 3, and regularized by these by the pseudo counts by your prior. Okay, so this is like Laplace smoothing for counts, but where you get to actually choose what that smoothing parameter is. Okay, is this we doing all right? Questions? Okay, so the Dirichlet distribution, like these fun exponential family things that we build these complicated objects out of, has some really cool properties. This property is actually a really interesting one, which basically is that if you have a distribution over these pies, you have a distribution over this simplex, and if we were to merge two of the pies, so go from like a five-dimensional outcome to a four-dimensional outcome, that thing that marginally also has a Dirichlet distribution, and the parameters just correspond to merging the two alphas, okay? This is actually like very, very similar to the property of the Gaussian distribution that Neil talked about, right? Where there's this idea that if you sort of lose some information, you marginalize out some dimensions you don't care about, then you get something that's still Gaussian and it has a form that you can compute. Almost exactly the same idea, except that now we just sort of have a different partitioning of our space. And this turns out to be the key property that allows you to make a Gaussian distribution infinite and go from Gaussian distribution to Gaussian process. It's going to be exactly the same kind of property that allows us to go from Dirichlet distribution to Dirichlet process. It's this idea that we can marginalize out things we don't care about very easily. Turns out in the Dirichlet multinomial, you can do the same thing, maybe not too surprisingly, with the counts themselves. And it's worth pointing out, just you know, if you're thinking about this for doing the lab session or whatever later, that it's quite easy to generate Dirichlet variates. You basically just generate k independent gamma variates where the shape parameter is determined by these alphas, and then you normalize them. So you get a bunch of positive numbers, and then you normalize them so they sum to 1. Okay, so let's do a little thought experiment. So this is my first time to Australia, and you know, you can imagine kind of going for a walk if you're like a total novice, and you encounter interesting animals in Australia. Such as this friendly thing called an inland taipan, I guess, which is like the deadliest snake in the world. Or you might encounter other kind of interesting things like saltwater crocodile, which I guess kills tons of people every year. You know, so you're walking along, and then Sydney funnel web spider, it's like the deadliest spider in the world. Box jellyfish, which is like incredibly poisonous, and you go for a swim. The bull shark, which I guess is, you know, not very friendly to surfers. And of course, the common death adder. You know, I love that there's like a common death. Anyway, so you know, you're like encountering some interesting friendly animals as on your first visit to Australia, like me. And you might wonder about, you know, how would I go about modeling animal species as I see them, right? So the idea is I'm going for a walk and I encounter a novel animal and I am going to like then count how many times I see a particular species and try to get a sense of like what the distribution is over the different possible species that live here. Okay, so taking this walk, see a new animal, see a new actual animal, and I catalog it according to what species it is. So I'm going to start with a prior on this. Maybe I use like a symmetric Dirichlet prior because I don't have any a priori reason to believe that, you know, one of these sort of integer labeled animals is more common than others. So then we're faced with this question immediately, right, which is, how big should k be? Okay, so I imagine there probably is in this case, a finite number of species, but I don't know, how many unique species are there in Australia?
Lots.
Okay, good. So that's the motivation for Bayesian nonparametric. Lots is like an answer we'd like to be able to write down. But we're actually literally faced with this, right? If we wanted to model these guys. And so the answer is there's like 200,000 distinct fauna that people kind of imagine exist. Of course, they haven't enumerated all of them, so they do this kind of funny censoring problem. But anyway, so we got to pick some giant number. But 200,000 is already like, it's already pretty big, and who knows, maybe there's even more. So the question is, how do we kind of reason about this where we know we're not going to see any substantial fraction of the total number of possible outcomes, right? And so in particular, we can ask this kind of really cool question, which is, if as I'm wandering along, what's the probability that I'm going to see some completely novel species? So I've seen a bunch of species so far, I've seen many animals. What's the probability that the next incredibly dangerous thing that I encounter is going to be something I've never seen before? Right? And this is something that we can compute by taking this very large symmetric Dirichlet, right? And most of those outcomes don't have any counts in them, but we can reason about how many things total don't have any counts associated with them. Right? So if we sort of go back, well, anyway, let's not go back. We can think about what the probability of a single novel outcome would be from that predicted distribution under the Dirichlet distribution, right? So this is, there's like a plus zero counts out here, but otherwise it's the same as the predictive we looked at before. And now there are k, so k total outcomes, and I've seen k sub n unique species so far, right? So that's how many sort of empty outcomes there are, species that I imagine might exist and I haven't seen an example yet. And the point is that if I'm sort of like, if there's a ton of species, there's a ton of different possible outcomes, and I'm only seeing a very small fraction of them, then this is going to be very close to K, right? And so then we can see that actually the probability, as I'm wandering around where I have not seen anything near sort of all the species that live here, is going to be something like alpha over alpha plus N. Yeah? So this is kind of interesting, right? There's no K. It's just saying as K gets really, really big, and I imagine that I have not seen a substantial fraction of all possible outcomes, and I can still reason about the probability of seeing something completely novel in the next, sort of the next, in the next thing I encounter. Okay? Does this kind of make sense? This is like the main, this is like the Dirichlet process trick, basically summarized. I mean, so we'll do like measure theory and stuff, but this is essentially what it comes down to and why people like this. Is I have some way, sort of at test time, to reason about actually seeing something completely novel. I never assume that I've seen everything all the time. Yeah?
What's the parameter alpha?
The parameter alpha is governing a sort of, we'll see it in a minute, but basically it's governing kind of the, it's kind of like an inverse variance for this Dirichlet distribution. Okay? So how centered around the mean, my mean expectation is. Here, because we're using a symmetric Dirichlet, we're saying that a priori I expect things to be uniform. The question is how much variability around uniform is there going to be? So if alpha is very small, then it prefers very, very sparse things, essentially. And then as alpha gets bigger, it prefers to become more and more uniform. Okay, so there's some interesting sort of considerations here in this little sort of like toy thing, you know, which is, for example, how do I decide when a particular animal that I've seen actually is sort of similar enough to one of my previous animals to lump it in with those same guys, right? You know, they all look a little bit different. Do the spots matter? Does it have a different color? Does this one have sort of, you know, more interesting sharp teeth or a novel kind of venom? And so naturally this leads us to say, well, we probably want an interesting sort of model of the variation for each of these species that we're going to encounter. And then it probably makes sense to learn that model for the species based on what I actually see, right? I see a bunch of saltwater crocodiles, and they all vary a little bit, and maybe once I've decided that they all belong to the same species, then I get a model for sort of like how, you know, how long they tend to be and so on. And probably from an inferential point of view, this means kind of iterating in some sense between updating what assignments I've created and also updating these models for each of the independent species, each of these different species. And this is exactly what we're doing when we build a mixture model, right? So what I've described here is kind of a mixture model over these animals. And in particular, a mixture model with a symmetric Dirichlet prior in some very large K, some very large potential number of species we might see. Okay, so the way the world is working now is that it's drawing, the generative model for these observations is that I'm drawing a species from this distribution, and then I'm generating sort of properties of that particular animal that I actually see in front of me based on that distribution. Okay? So what we're going to do is kind of talk about what happens when we make K big and then try to hopefully make it a little bit more rigorous, although today we're not going to sort of like obsess too much over rigor, because that's what reading the papers is for. And instead, we'll sort of try to focus a little bit on intuition and so on. Okay, so the idea here is we have this like finite mixture model with k possible outcomes. So recall that every one of these latent labels, so this is a latent species, Zn. There's some overall distribution pi over what species we might encounter. And then the actual properties of the animal we see, given its latent species and the properties of that species, produce our actual observations from some distribution f that is sort of parameterized, or is a family of distributions parameterized by theta. And then we put this symmetric Dirichlet prior on pi in terms of this kind of inverse variance alpha, right? So this is the same model we had before, but it's kind of formalizing this idea. Now we can think about inference. And this is, like I said, the way that people arrived at sort of the Dirichlet process, kind of when people first started thinking about this a couple of decades ago. The idea is what we can do is try to perform inference by writing down a Markov chain, by building a Markov chain Monte Carlo algorithm that contains all of the unknown variables here. So we can, for example, we don't know each of the actual sort of unique species identifiers associated with everything we've seen, and we don't know what the parameters are of those guys. But we can write down a big joint distribution using this generative model, using that probabilistic model from the previous slide, and then we can update different parts of that and kind of simulate this thing forward to make inferences about what the different species are, who belongs to what cluster, and so on. Okay, so there's two kinds of updates in this kind of simple setup. One is to update the assignments of each of our data according to the posterior that it belongs to one of those, to that particular class. Here I'm using lowercase f to indicate the density associated with the distribution that I've been using uppercase f for, but still it's parameterized by theta k. We'll also want to update these mixture proportions, that is the pi's, which just has this, because of this conjugate prior, allows us to do sort of a very simple Gibbs update, because it's also Dirichlet distributed. And then we'll also need to update the mixture component parameters themselves, the thetas. So here I'm writing lowercase h for the density associated with that uppercase h prior distribution, multiplied by a product of all the sort of, so this is a bunch of likelihoods. This is each of the data that particular cluster explains. And so these thetas are now the sort of the parameters associated with that species. Okay, so these are the kind of updates that we would have if we were just going to run a vanilla Gibbs sampler on a finite mixture model. And a little bit more generally, if it turns out that you can do some nice things like for example, if you chose a conjugate prior for your parameters, then it can turn out that you might be able to get away with actually sort of integrating out everything except for the component assignments, so you can marginalize pi and these thetas, and to get what we call a collapsed Gibbs sampler for this finite mixture model. What we're going to do is iterate over each of the data and sort of integrating out the pi's, use that predicted distribution to decide a priori which cluster it would want to belong to, okay, weighted by the likelihood associated with that cluster. Okay, and ideally, you would actually integrate the thetas out of that and not even have to actually represent those. Although, so you can do that in like conjugate exponential family type models like Gaussians, but it's harder to do it more generally. But for now, let's just imagine that we can do that, so that's like a student T distribution or something. So that's what I'm writing here, is that, you know, the idea that we could take the guys that belong to a particular cluster and then get the predictive distribution, integrating out the parameters that actually live there. If you can get away with that, then this results in a much nicer, what we call a collapsed Gibbs sampler, because that is a smaller state space. And all you're doing is running around updating these cluster assignments. Okay, so it's at this point that we can start to think about making K really big and sort of, again, think about this kind of infinite limit. Okay, so if K was very, very large, right, then we basically kind of, and we're going to basically take one of our data, and we're going to decide what cluster to move it to. There are two situations. One is that we're going to move it to a cluster that currently has some other data assigned to it, right? And that has this posterior predictive under that Dirichlet distribution, again, weighted by the likelihood. or we put it into a cluster that actually doesn't have any data at all associated with it. And that's exactly that little computation we did earlier about what's the probability of seeing a completely novel species. So these are the two possible things that basically can happen in this collapsed Gibbs family. You're iterating over all the data, you pick somebody up, you either move it into a cluster that already has some data, or you move it to a completely new one. Now we can look at these two places where this K appears, and we can imagine that K is getting really, really big. Right? So we're going to take this limit, and we wind up with same two kinds of updates, but now, and by the way, these etas here are like, so this notation here is a kind of a relatively common way to talk about these counts. So this is the number of guys in cluster K, and then this sort of negation of N means excluding the datum N, all right? So the idea is that you get this predictive distribution. We're imagining the predictive distribution from all N minus one, big N minus one, being applied now to the particular guy that we're updating. Okay, so it's like all the counts for everybody else but you, because we don't want to double count you. All right, so there's two possible things. This prior is basically how popular is that cluster, weighted by how well it explains the data, versus the sort of a priori probability of just starting a new cluster against what like that cluster would, how well it would explain you, sort of predictively given no observation. So integrating out just the prior. So there's no K, right? So the kind of the cool thing here is that we have these two update equations. We kind of have a way to run inference in a mixture model that started off being finite but now has no reference to K. Okay? So this is the kind of the first way that at least the machine learning community sort of started thinking about these kind of infinite models, and it's actually kind of been reinvented this way kind of multiple times. It doesn't really make sense because each cluster would actually have probability zero, and so there's kind of some issues with the math actually working out. Also, kind of referencing what I said earlier, we really don't want to define models by their inference procedures, right? We like to keep inference separate from the modeling that we want to do. And also, as we'll see, it's only going to work out in the case where we're sort of talking about Dirichlet process mixture models and not sort of more general kinds of models that we might want to use something like a Dirichlet process for. And it turns out there's some more precise ways that we can get at these ideas, in particular something called the Chinese restaurant process. And so we'll wind up sort of talking about that as a way to sort of actually have a kind of something that feels a little bit more rigorous for what it means to have an infinite mixture model. But in general, when somebody attaches the word process to some distribution that sounds familiar to you, then you really want to just think about sort of a collection, an infinite collection of those random variables. Right, just like in the Gaussian case. Questions at this point? This is a great time to ask questions. Yep. Well, so we're imagining that the samples are not biased, right? They're IID from a model that has this form, right? So we're not going to try to deal with model mismatch right now. What we're trying to do is just reason about kind of what happens if we actually had a mixture model. How would that, you know, what would happen as the number of components kind of went to infinity? Okay. Yeah.
How common is the city funnel spider in Sydney?
I don't know. But has anybody encountered a Sydney funnel? That seems relevant, doesn't it? Yeah. Okay. So so now what we're going to talk about is a little bit of the nitty gritty associated with this object that is going to sit behind this kind of limit. And the Dirichlet process was first sort of invented in its current form in like 1973. And to get a handle on it, we're going to have to do a little bit of probability theory. And by probability theory, I sort of mean like measure theoretic probability. It's really funny, actually. So teaching probability, I teach undergrads, and you know, if you talk to somebody who's like a computer scientist or an engineer or something, you ask them, like, how well do you understand probability? They will always say that they understand probability very well. It's like people who don't really know much probability, they sort of, you know, they're like, oh, you're just talking about dice and things, right? And like, I understand dice, I understand probability. And then you talk to like somebody who has like a first level engineering course and they've seen some expectations and univariate things. And you ask them if they understand probability, they will say yes. And then you talk to like, you know, a grad student in the math department, and they're the only people who might say no. And that's because they realize that sort of, you know, like I don't understand probability, I would say. Because like actual probability looks like this, but it's interesting teaching, right? Because you try to interrogate people to help calibrate them for a course, and then they always say that they understand probability and will be fine, even if they like don't. Anyway, so the so we have to do just a little bit of measure theory here to sort of like set this up. And it's gonna be a little bit informal. And despite my sort of like prior, which is that, you know, the joke is that the useful set of measure theory has measure zero. All right, not too many people laughed about that. That's a joke. Okay, so anyway, the point is we're going to have some set that we care about. All right, so the set is going to be this capital theta here. And the idea is that there's a sigma algebra over that set. So this is a collection of subsets of theta with some properties. That is, the sigma algebra can't be empty, so your set of sets must have at least one. And if you have something that is a member of this set, then its complement must also be in that set, in the sigma algebra. And also, it has to be closed under countable union. So if you have a collection of sets, then their union must also be in the set. When we take the space and such a big set of sets, from our point of view, this is like all the interesting sets. So on the real line, you know, like Neil briefly mentioned Borel sets, same idea going on here. And what we're going to say is this is a measure space, and these sets are the measurable sets. And then there's some function that we call the measure, all right? That's mu here, and then it takes one of these guys in the sigma algebra, and it produces some non-negative number, okay? And that's like the size. So when somebody says the measure of something, you like want to hear the word size. It's like, if it were a continuous function or something, it's just like taking the integral of it or something. It's volume is kind of the thing you want to hear when somebody says measure, okay? This measure needs to have a couple of properties, which is that like the volume of the empty set needs to be zero. That seems like a reasonable thing to want. And it also needs to have the property that if I take two different sets and I sum their measures, then that needs to be the same as, so if they're disjoint sets, and I take the measure, each of their measures separately, and I add that together, it needs to be the same as the measure of the union of these guys. So the volume intuition is basically the same, that if I have three buckets of water, and they each have volumes, and I pour them into one big bucket of water, then that volume of the resulting bucket needs to be the same as the sum of each of the buckets separately. A probability measure just has the property that the measure of everything taken altogether is one. Okay, that you can't assign more than probability one to all of the possible outcomes. All right? So the language around this stuff, the notation, can be a little bit confusing. People get wound up about these technical definitions. Everything we care about is going to be measurable. There's not going to be anything, we're not going to do anything too exciting. There's a couple of properties that we do care about, which is, you know, sort of maps between these guys, and we say the function between these two spaces is measurable if every set that you care about one is also in the other. And a random variable on a probability measure is basically just a function from our point of view from this latent theta space into some other space that we care about. All right, this is not that bad. Think of the probability space as being like a random number generator on your computer. Okay, so it generates numbers like between 0 and 1. You call rand on your computer, gives you these numbers, and then you're going to do something else with them, right? You're going to map them into some space to turn them into Gaussian random variables or whatever you want, and that map is kind of basically what's going on with this kind of like probability space and random variables. Then a stochastic process is just basically saying that I can generate a collection of random variables from the same underlying space. So I can use kind of one, you know, I can use like one kind of like little set of random number generators to produce a collection of random variables. Okay, and this again gets back to like what Neil was talking about with Gaussian processes, where you want to think of this process as being a big joint draw from a Gaussian distribution. Okay, they're all correlated and complicated, and that's because they share a single underlying kind of probability space. All right, So the point, though, is that in a stochastic process, this index set, this collection, could be countably infinite or uncountably infinite. It could be really big. And so we get this very large set of sort of correlated random variables that we can then do fun stuff with. All right, so this is why we like them from a modeling point of view. Okay, so the Ferguson definition for a Dirichlet process, we start with some measure space. And now let's imagine that we have what we call a measurable finite partitioning. So we have some space that we care about, and we're going to chop it up into subsets. We're going to partition it in such a way that every one of the sets still lives in our sigma algebra, but let's just assume that we don't have to worry about that. And this kind of finite measurable partitioning is going to have the property that's finite, so there's not an infinite number of partitions. It's measurable. They all live in every one of them lives in the sigma algebra. Disjoint, so none of the sets overlap. And it's also sort of complete. What by this I just mean that like if you take the union of them all, then you get the original whole set back. So it's just a partition. A Dirichlet process is a random measure. Okay? It is a random measure. So that what that means is given your partitioning, okay? So if you start out with the partitioning, say chopping your space up into like these sets A1 through AK, okay? Then the size of those guys is going to be Dirichlet distributed according to some sort of prior parameters that you put on that measure space, so alpha and h. So alpha and h are like parameters of this distribution. And the idea basically is that h is what we call generally a base measure. So it's like whatever you sort of a priori thought that these things, how big you thought a priori they should be. And then alpha is just as before, this like inverse variance. Okay, so this is kind of a direct generalization of what we did earlier, except now instead of just having alpha 1 through alpha k, I now have this kind of function because the way I partition the set into these guys into these a's could be different sort of on any given day. Okay, so alpha we often call a concentration parameter, or like I said, kind of an inverse variance. We call h like a base probability measure. Sometimes you'll see these guys multiplied together to make something that is not just a probability measure, but is an arbitrary measure. So if you see somebody talk about a Dirichlet process that looks like this, that's what they're doing. They're kind of just rolling them together into one parameter. This has a mean and a variance. So the random measures that you get, their means are just the h. They're just whatever you started off with. And then it has this variance that kind of looks kind of like you would get from the Dirichlet distribution. Okay, so this has a nice sort of predictive distribution. The mean, the mean of this thing is the predictive, just like it is for the Dirichlet. It has some funny properties. So this is kind of the main object we're going to talk about today. It has some funny properties. In particular, it produces densities. It doesn't produce densities. It produces probability measures that are going to be discrete with probability 1, even if H itself has a density. It's going to turn out that the random things, I'm going to use G to indicate random probability measures that arise from a Dirichlet process. We're going to be able to write this as a mixture of Dirac delta functions, which we'll kind of come back to. And it's going to be, like I said, a little bit funny because H can have a density and be smooth, but it's still, the Dirichlet process still produces pointy things. And to sort of like kind of think about this a little bit, and I'm going to produce some visualizations here in a second. There's this kind of like crazy thing that's going on, right? Which, as I said earlier, the Dirichlet distribution has the property that if I take two outcomes and I stick them together, then the marginal distribution over how big, what the probability is of that joint outcome is just the sum of the two alphas, right? So that carries over to this Dirichlet process, and that's kind of like where all the action is, in almost exactly the same way that it's where all the action is in the Gaussian process. This idea that we can marginalize out the difference between two sets, AJ and AK. So that is to say that the random measure that I get associated with these two sets must have the same distribution as if I first took their union and then found the distribution over their union. And this has to be true for all possible partitions. And that's like the crazy thing. Is that no matter what your partitions is, no matter what your A's are, this has to hold true. And it has to be consistent no matter how you slice it up, no matter how you merge things together, it always has to have the same set of marginals, as long as it's a finite partition. There's also this really kind of interesting property, which is that if you start with a union of two sets, and I split them into, and I split the A's into an AJ and AK, I can also find the random partitioning of those, and that's just going to have a beta distribution that I can compute, and that is that uses the base measure of each of those guys. I think there should be alphas in there. Okay, so this is to sort of help you think about why this would wind up being giving you discrete random measures. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to take advantage of that last property of this kind of like random splitting of these measures, and we're going to like run that down. So here's what we're going to do. Let's imagine that we have that this is just like the unit interval here. So it's like 0 to 1. And what I've done is I've generated a random measure represented by two bars in a bar graph where I'm assigning, so these are meant to sum to 1. And what I've done is I've created two sets like A1 and A2 by slicing in the middle. And then I know because of the Ferguson property that their joint, that the distribution over those two measures is going to be beta. It's just going to be a beta distribution, right? Because the beta is the two outcome special case of the Dirichlet distribution. And then I took sort of a unit mass and I allocated it randomly between these two sides. Okay? And I can recurse and do this again. Okay, because again, this kind of like property where I can take, you know, the idea of the Ferguson properties, I can take two disjoint subsets and continue to split them in this random way. So I take this mass and I can split it into these guys, and this mass splits into those guys using exactly the same idea. And I can recurse this deeper and deeper. But what happens is, as the parameters of this, as we go down, the parameters of the betas that I'm using to split become smaller and smaller. They become closer to zero because the measure that I'm chopping up is becoming smaller and smaller. And what happens when you have a beta distribution that has very small parameters? What does that look like? Let's try this. So what happens when you have a beta distribution? So the beta distribution is just between 0 and 1. Cool. Right? And initially, you know, like a beta 1, 1 distribution is just uniform, right? Between 0 and 1. But what happens is if the parameters get really small, then it starts to look like a horseshoe. It starts to look, get these huge spikes on the edge. Okay, so what's happening here is as we go down, making these splits, then it becomes more biased towards one side relative to the other. Every little time I chop this, like this guy, has some mass, well, even here. I split them up, and the other side in each case is basically going to zero. Now, these volumes don't exactly add up because I'm sort of renormalizing every time to make it look like a density, and they become sort of delta functions. But this is kind of the intuition about why this reduces discrete distributions. So this is with alpha equals 1. But we could also look at how this is modulated for different alphas. So alpha being larger is going to result in distributions that are more uniform. So this is a little better behaved. But still, even as we go down, so we now have more spikes. But again, we wind up with this random measure that is super spiky. Okay, does everybody see kind of what I'm doing here? I'm creating a kind of like a sequence of nested partitions. Every time I'm splitting these guys in half, and then I'm taking the mass and I'm using this nice Ferguson property to sort of allocate it to every single, you know, sort of to divide that mass up. And what's happening is that as it goes down, it's just that distribution is becoming very extreme, and so it's tending to break up into little bitty spikes. We can do this with yep. So the area is not 1 because I can't draw delta functions, basically, because as they become really, really thin, then they would shoot off sort of like forever. And so I'm normalizing every one of them, basically, to make it look like a density. Yeah, but it's, yeah, so, and then I'm having to shrink it to fit it on the slide. So it's like, so think about it relative to within each picture. So this is with a larger alpha, so it becomes closer to uniform. So now we're getting lots and lots of these little spikes. Okay, so That was with a uniform base measure. But remember I said earlier that the idea was that that we could have this like non-uniform H, and that H is the mean of this distribution. It's a little bit weird because H can be smooth, but the random measures that we get are going to be super spiky. So here's the blue line is a simple Gaussian distribution base measure, and then I'm showing different very, very spiky draws from a Dirichlet process. So you can see why we think of these as being mixtures of delta functions. Okay, and the idea basically being that as alpha goes, so the mean of these spikes, in some sense, the mean of the measure that we get is the blue line, which seems crazy, but as we increase alpha, you can kind of see why that might be the case, right? That it's kind of allocating measure more and more. If alpha is very small, then it's very sparse, as we said earlier, and so you just wind up with like one big guy. But his location is drawn essentially according to the base measure. So part of the reason we like the Dirichlet process is because even though this, like, it's crazy as a model, it's conjugate to arbitrary observations in theta, okay? So what I mean by that is that imagine that we had a random measure that was drawn from a Dirichlet process with parameters alpha and h, and then we saw some data. Now, I'm going to imagine these data are theta sub n. I'll get back to, we'll see in a minute why we use theta instead of x here. So I'm imagining that the likelihood is G, right? G is a density. So, or it's not a density, but it's a probability measure. So we can get data from it. And now we can ask the question, you know, what's the posterior distribution over that measure given that we've seen a bunch of thetas? It has a Dirichlet process distribution. And this is basically almost exactly like the multinomial Dirichlet distribution conjugacy, except just now we have like this uncountably infinite possible number of outcomes. So what happens now is the alpha in the posterior distribution, alpha is going to go up by n, the number of data that we saw, and we're going to wind up, and the new h is going to be essentially a mixture of the old h with a bunch of these delta functions at the data we've seen. Okay? So you can see what's going on here. We have alpha multiplied by old h, and then a sum of all the previous data we've seen in this posterior, normalized by alpha over n. Just like in the Dirichlet multinomial case, we can compute the predictive distribution, this posterior predictive, integrating out all possible g's. And it's just the mean of that distribution, so it's just going to be h, right? And so it has this form. And what's cool here is that if we sort of like rewrite this a little bit, we could say, what's the probability of a completely novel object, right? So it's a mixture between a completely new draw from H, so putting down a new spike under this Gaussian distribution, versus the probability that we see something from the empirical measure of the data by itself. Okay, so this is saying there's a spike, there's a 1 over n spike at every datum we've ever seen, right? And it's either going to be one of the things we've seen before, it's either going to be a species that we've seen before, or with some probability, it's going to be something completely novel drawn from the prior on species, H, okay? And the probability of seeing something completely novel goes down as A over A plus N. So as we see more things, then the probability of seeing something novel decreases. So this has some interesting, this kind of interesting clustering property. So we can think of this as basically a kind of a way to like draw data. So in the beginning, we're going to draw a datum, and it's going to come from H, right? And then in the second datum we draw, there's going to be some probability that we draw a completely new object and some probability that we actually pick up the same object that we just had because of this delta function, because this atom we just introduced into the posterior distribution. Okay, so this leads to some cool sort of like it leads to something called the Chinese restaurant process, which we'll talk about in a second, but it also leads to this idea called a Polya-Urn scheme, or Blackwell-McQueen-Urn scheme. So this is the predicted distribution. So it starts out with n equals 0, right? And so if n equals 0, then there's no old data that we can draw, so we get something from H to begin with. And then n is equal to 1, and there's some probability, again, that we draw something completely novel, or that we draw that delta function again. And so you can imagine kind of the idea with the poly-urn scheme is we imagine that there's an urn, and the urn has alpha specially colored balls in it to begin with. So this like little rainbow thing is alpha equals one. And now what's going to happen is in poly-use urn, we draw a ball from the urn. Okay, it's going to be the stripy ball, right? Because that's the only one there, right? And now if you draw a stripy ball, then you paint a ball a completely novel color and put them both back into the urn. Okay, so this is just like drawing from H, where H is a distribution over colors. Put them back in the urn, and now you draw uniformly over the balls that are in Polya's urn. So let's imagine that we draw the red ball back out. If we draw a ball with a color that we've seen before, then we return to it two of that color. And then we draw again. And so this is just like exactly the Dirichlet multinomial, except that occasionally we introduce these completely novel colors. All right, so every time we draw the stripy ball, we add back in a completely new color, and then we keep going. All right, so this is exactly what the Dirichlet process kind of idea is, where the colors are coming from H, and with some probability we add a new color, and with some probability we add another of one of our existing colors. So you might be able to kind of see why this leads to clustering behavior, right? Because once you've seen an example of something before, then it upweights your probability of seeing the same thing again. But at no point do you ever say, I've seen everything. And that's kind of why we like these guys. So there's kind of like obviously annoying math, but actually the fact that there's these kind of delta functions living in there are exactly what's causing this cool behavior. There's positive probability of seeing exactly the same thing again next time, right? And that's why we get clusters. That's why we get groups, because these are data that have like this, that are exactly the same in some sense. So people don't use, at least I don't think, people sort of use the poly-urn setup very often for sort of like implementing things. But the Chinese restaurant process, who's heard of the Chinese restaurant process? Like quite a few people. So this is something that we build samplers around. It has a nice kind of intuitive meaning. It's a prior over partitions, and it has a kind of a similar feel. All right, so as I said, there's this nice clustering property, which is basically that in this, you know, as I iterate this thing forward, and there's sort of not probability one I'll get something completely new, but some probability I'll get exactly the same guys again, then I have a number of clusters. I have a number of unique values that is less than the total number of data, which is like exactly what a clustering model is. And what we're going to say is that basically everybody that belongs to a particular theta is one of these groups, is one of these clusters, okay? And that gives us a random partitioning of the data, okay? Like, so we can think of the all of the data that belong to a particular theta as being in a group, and then the group segment the end data that we've seen. And that random partitioning is what the Chinese restaurant process is. Okay, so the idea is we have some set S. Sort of we're going to think about that as just being the integers 1 to n. A partition row is just a non-empty set of subsets of S, all right? And we're going to denote the space of such partitions with this kind of math cal P sub S. A random partition is a random variable that takes values in this set of possible partitions. Okay, so this Chinese restaurant is such a random variable, all right? So the idea that sort of the Chinese restaurant process story is that there's a Chinese restaurant that has an infinite number of tables, and people are going to walk into this restaurant and sit at the tables, and what tables are sitting at is inducing a partition over the n people that have walked in, okay? And the idea is we're going to set things up so that the popular tables tend to become more popular. There's this like rich get richer type effect. And the way it works is, first person comes in and always sits at the first table, okay? But then later people are going to have to choose between either sitting at an existing table or starting a new table. And they're going to have some fixed probability, not fixed probability, but a probability as a function of alpha and n, of sitting at a completely new table all by themselves, or joining one of the existing tables according to its current popularity. Okay, so this eta k is how many people are currently sitting there. When that gets big, then you become more interested in sitting in that table. It's like, you know, it's like the high school lunch table process or something. Everybody wants to sit at the popular table. And some people go off and have to sit on all by themselves. All right, but maybe then a friend comes along and sits with them later, if they're lucky. All right, so second person walks in, sees the popular table, decides to randomly choose to sit with the first person. Third person starts their own table. Fourth person maybe starts their own table too. Then other people are basically coming in, again, choosing with this probability whether or not to start something new or whether to sit at one of the existing ones according to its popularity. So you can see why we think of this as producing a random partitioning of a set of, say, seven numbers, right? Because now, essentially, people are joining the existing groups according to their popularity in this sequential way. Okay, so this is a prior that we call the Chinese restaurant process. So it has this kind of interesting thing. It allows for a kind of an unbounded number of tables. Obviously, you can't ever occupy more tables than there are data. It has the property that, in particular, what we kind of call preferential attachment, which is that the popular tables tend to become more popular, so the rich get richer. It also has this amazing property that underlies essentially all of the models we talk about in Bayesian nonparametrics, which is that it's exchangeable. That is, it turns out that the distribution over partitions does not depend on the order that the customers come into the restaurant. Okay, that actually, if you compute the distribution over the partitions, that you could permute all of the indices and have them come in a different order, and they would still get the same distribution. And if you compute that probability over different partitions, you get something called the exchangeable partition probability function. And essentially, it's a distribution over the permutations themselves, over the partitions themselves, in terms of the size of them, so how many subsets are, how many unique tables are occupied, and how big each one of those are, but with no reference to the actual indices themselves. It's something you can kind of work out by hand, if you're sort of inclined, to basically take those sequential computations, and if you sort of write out the chain of conditional probabilities, you'll see that basically all the things that look like they depend on the specific identities turn into things that just depend on the total number of people currently sitting at that table. And so it all sort of cancels out in this kind of cute way. So the knobs that you have to turn here is alpha. And so you can kind of estimate here psi is the di gamma function. That's the derivative of the log gamma function. But the point is that we can kind of compute the expected number of tables that will be occupied and the variance around those. And we can look at how, for example, if 1,000 people came into the restaurant and these are sort of the indices of the tables, when alpha is 1, then only sort of 4 tables get occupied, right? And as we increase alpha, then more and more tables get occupied, right? So people tend to sit with high probability at a completely new table as alpha gets bigger, right? So then you wind up with a partitioning where you have a lot of sort of very small sets. Okay, so this is exactly what I mean by sort of thinking about this as a distribution over partitions. And so we've got 1,000 people. How are they dividing themselves among these different integers? Okay, so this is a very nice way to think about the distribution of partitions. We'll come back to it in a second. It's exactly the kind of the equations for these priors are exactly what we saw in the limit of the finite mixture model. So these are kind of one of the so when I was saying that people sort of eventually figured out that you could formalize this idea of taking the limit of a finite mixture model, essentially what they were sort of discovering was this Chinese restaurant process interpretation of an underlying random measure. When Ferguson came up with the Dirichlet process in sort of 1973, I think my impression is that people sort of, I wasn't around, but my impression is that people sort of was like, oh, that's really cool. It's an interesting Bayesian take on nonparametrics. But it wasn't until there was a constructive definition in the form of the stick breaking process that people really sort of figured out how to actually do a lot of computation with it and make it into something practical in a lot of different settings. So the idea with the stick breaking process, this is another construction of the Dirichlet process, is to observe that since the random measure that we get, G, has this form of an infinite number of delta functions, okay, so it's this infinite sequence of draws from H, that we can actually talk about the distribution over the pi's themselves, and that the distribution over the thetas is going to be, they're going to be basically IID from this underlying base measure H. Okay, so we can reason about this joint distribution over the pi's and the thetas without having to worry about the sort of like necessarily without necessarily having to think about kind of like these like, you know, finite partitions and so on. There are at least kind of two ways to do this: stick breaking construction and the Poisson-Dirichlet distribution. This is kind of cool, but not terribly tractable. On the other hand, the stick breaking construction we like quite a lot. It turns out to be very simple. So you can come up with the pies for a Dirichlet process by doing this kind of thing. You start with a stick of unit length, and you draw a beta random variable that has parameters 1 and alpha. Okay? And you take the stick and you break it at the location of that beta random variable, and the piece that you keep, here I'm drawing it on the right, is going to be pi 1, and then the rest of it, that's now going to be less than 1, you draw another beta random variable and you break that stick in proportion to this second beta random variable, and that becomes pi 2. And you can just sort of recurse this thing down, breaking the stick into smaller and smaller pieces. It'll get, the pies will get smaller in expectation, but not necessarily strictly. And this distribution over this infinite sequence of pies that you get is often called the GEM distribution, the Griffiths, Ingen, and McCluskey distribution. It has some cool properties, like it's invariant under size bias permutation, which is basically a way to think about the kind of the random ordering, which is sort of weak preference for bigger things coming first. I mentioned this Poisson-Dirichlet distribution, which is the same kind of thing, but with a strict ordering on a strictly decreasing ordering on the pies, but it doesn't really have a nice sort of tractable form. So I should say that, by the way, the thetas that are associated with each of these pies, you just get to draw those IID from H. So this is kind of cool and simple, right? It's this, basically you're sort of breaking the stick into smaller and smaller pieces. That gives you a sequence of pies, and then you draw the thetas independently from H, and that gives you, and together, these give you a kind of explicit form, you know, out to some big K of what all of the of what your random G is drawn from this Dirichlet distribution. So you can kind of see why this might be useful for constructing things like MCMC samplers, because you get this like very explicit representation. So let's kind of talk a little bit about how you do inference in a mixture model based on these ideas. Question? Yep.
Just going back a little bit to that alpha parameter. So presumably the tuning parameter lets you sort of characterize how many samples you want. So how do you sort of search over that space to figure out how many, what do you want to consider prior or after, or do you just search for the clustering?
Great question. So, I mean, you could be a subjective Bayesian and sort of write down an alpha and live with it. Or it turns out to have a relatively simple form that I think you're going to talk about tomorrow, Ray is going to talk about tomorrow. And it's something that you can do. It turns out to be, I think, log concave conditioned on the sort of the assignments that is under that thing I showed you earlier. And so you can sample from it and infer it kind of relatively straightforwardly. And it's just a scalar relative to all these things. So. But from an sort of like an inductive bias point of view, it's kind of where everything is going on, right? Because if you have, it's saying like how many distinct groups for a given n do I expect? Just like what these curves are about here. So why don't I sort of like talk about inference for just a minute and then 2 minutes? 3 minutes, okay. So we're not gonna go into detail. Essentially what we're gonna say is almost exactly the mixture model like we had before, excuse me. What we're saying is that we have a G that's drawn from a Gaussian, that's drawn from a Dirichlet process, and that every one of our data is going to be drawn from an F, where the thetas associated with that F are draws from this DP. So you wind up with this very simple plate diagram, and it results in clusters, right? Because when you go back to the G, you may get something that you've seen before. Right, so you'll tend to have X's that belong to the same theta with positive probability. So there's three different representations that people think about using when they do inference with these guys. So one is to use the Chinese restaurant process, so to just write down the CRP and try to deal with that because it's simple and looks a lot like the finite mixture model case. If you have something more complicated, you can use the stick breaking representation. And then there's another kind of newer representation where you can explicitly try to represent the random measure G. So with the Chinese restaurant process, it looks very familiar, basically. What you're doing is saying that you have, so you're gonna try to integrate the G out. And the idea is that you're actually going to deal with these kind of latent assignments to the different clusters and update them according to that kind of that CRP rule, but now weighted with the likelihoods. So it's almost, again, it's almost exactly like the limiting case of the finite mixture model, and that we don't have to choose k. Essentially, what you're going to do is iterate over the data, assign them to different clusters. If it's all nice and sort of conjugate, then you'll be able to assign them to new tables or completely novel tables, integrating out the thetas. More commonly, if things are not conjugate, then you'll have to do something a little bit fancier. This paper, and I should say that's a little bit trickier, but basically what you're trying to do is figure out when you can assign something to a completely new table. This paper in 2000 by Radford Neal is kind of like the best reference. The algorithm that everybody uses is called algorithm 8 from this paper. So in this space, very often you'll see people just say, oh, I used algorithm 8. And what they mean is there are many numbered algorithms in this paper, and the one that seems to work the best with the Chinese restaurant process is algorithm 8. The point is basically it's exactly like that finite case. It's just with the CRP rule explicit rather than kind of like hand-wavy infinite limit setup. In the stick-breaking representation, you can just basically exactly explicitly represent the pies, and it's kind of nice because I say left to right here, but in my figure I went right to left. The point is that as things get really small, they become very, very unlikely. And there are these clever tricks you can do to never actually have to create the thing, these sort of very small probability sticks and their parameters. And so there's some slice sampling tricks and some truncation things that you can do that allow you to sort of deal with this infinite sequence without actually like creating an infinite sequence. Because basically these tiny little weights and their parameters don't sort of have to live on your computer. The downside of the stick-breaking representation is that it imposes an ordering on these atoms that you don't really care about, right? That's like a nuisance variable, essentially. And so you have to resample that ordering over the sticks in order to have any kind of reasonable mixing. This is what the size bias permutation sort of thing is all about. There's a few different samplers you can check out that use this representation. The idea of an explicit G measure is basically to try to observe that that in this predictive distribution, your G is a mixture between completely new things and all of your old things, and that you can eliminate this ordering by essentially saying that I'm going to have an unordered representation over my existing things, and then use a stick-breaking representation over the completely novel things. So this helps mixing a little bit because now you have this kind of semi-ordered representation where you don't have to worry about ordering over your data, but you can instead only worry about ordering when you occasionally have to introduce a completely new component. There's other inference things out there, split merge ideas, some new ideas on sequential Monte Carlo, and then also some variational approximations that use these representations. We're not going to talk about kind of going into any of this stuff in detail, but there's a large literature out there. So why don't we stop here for the break? I know that was probably a little bit intense because there's a lot of kind of things going on, many different objects and processes, and if like you hadn't seen the Dirichlet distribution before, then it's like infinite dimensional older brother is like really not going to be that easy. So let's take a step back and are there some questions that we can answer, some things I can clear up, some things we can review before we sort of like charge forth into more complicated variants? Yeah. Okay, so the question is, what are the situations in which I might use a Dirichlet process type mixture model versus like a Gaussian process, like Neil talked about? So what Neil was talking about was basically regression and related problems, right? Where supervised learning, I have some inputs and I have some outputs. So I want to have an object that, that takes in, maybe takes in properties of some molecule I care about and estimates its photovoltaic efficiency, or some kind of regression where I have tuples of sort of features and labels. And the generalized version of here's an image, is this a cat or a dog, right? So that's what Gaussian processes are about, is random functions. Could be a spatial function where you're talking about things like, how does the distribution of some pollutant vary according to a function of as a function of space. Dirichlet processes are basically about density estimation. So I only see features and I don't see labels. Okay, so unsupervised learning is what Dirichlet processes are about, and Gaussian processes are about supervised learning. And then sort of mixture model type variants are where you then take that Dirichlet process and make it into like a density estimator or into clustering, where I'm gonna now look at the groups that like a Chinese restaurant process induces, and I'm going to care about the clusters. I'm gonna care about the groups, but unlike maybe kind of k-means, I can instead kind of not have to pin myself down to a particular number of groups. I'm gonna sort of put an asterisk on that because it turns out there's consistency reasons why that's a bad idea, but that's the intuition that you wanna have, is not having to choose a particular sort of K for your finite mixture model. Other questions? Okay, so what I'm gonna do is sort of dive into some more, some variations on this that sort of are, the Dirichlet process is mostly used for mixture modeling, for this idea of I want to have a flexible mixture model with a lot of components for density estimation or sort of variations thereof. People also like it a little bit in natural language and things like that, but it's more commonly used in some ways for in the form called a hierarchical Dirichlet process. And in particular, it's a way to take something like a Dirichlet process and make it usable for topic modeling. It's the way to do it's one way, essentially, to do a non-parametric generalization of something like latent Dirichlet allocation. So latent Dirichlet allocation, is this something that everybody's seen before? Some people have seen before? Okay, so a topic model is a way to model documents, most commonly, where the idea is that a corpus of documents is going to have a set of topics that are things that might be talked about in any particular document. So there might be rugby, there might be something on wild animals, there might be something on politics. These might be different topics that could be talked about in a particular document. So we're saying a document is gonna be composed of a small number of topics. A topic itself is a distribution over words. So here's kind of a visualization in which topics, so here we have four different topics. Each of these topics is a distribution over words, so there's some words that are more likely than others. So maybe this is like a neuroscience topic, which assigns high probability to neuroscience words, and that's like a genetics topic that assigns high probability to words like DNA. Okay? Then the idea is that a particular document has a distribution over those topics, okay? And the way that we're gonna generate a document is by ticking along, taking every word, drawing first its topic from its distribution, and then drawing the actual word from that topic's distribution over the vocabulary, right? And we do that, and we generate it. And the idea is that by using a distribution here that induces sparsity, then every document is only about a few topics. And the point of something like latent Dirichlet allocation is to be able to discover coherent topics through word co-occurrence within documents. Okay, that if I see the word Barack and the word Obama and the word president, then and these things co-occur in a lot of different documents, then perhaps I can infer that there's a latent sort of shared source of those that is this single coherent topic. Okay, so this is a really common thing to want to do. It's in latent Dirichlet allocation, it's very successful. It's a little bit frustrating because you have to pick the number of topics that you're going to deal with in advance. And so much like trying to go from a finite mixture model to an infinite mixture model, we'd like to go from a finite topic model to an infinite topic model where we don't have to choose this number of topics in advance. So latent Dirichlet allocation in the finite version, as I said, has this idea that there's a set of topics. So a topic here is now a distribution over words, and there's k of them. They're going to be defined by these thetas. And then the idea is that every document, so there's n documents, this outer plate here, and every one of those has a distribution over topics. Every word in the document has a latent topic associated with it. And then the actual vocabulary word arises from whatever topic it was, modulating the actual global corpus. So it has this kind of generative model. You might think that you could generalize this by replacing the Dirichlet distribution associated with every document with a Dirichlet process. That seems like the nice sort of natural thing to do. There's a problem with doing this, though, which is that because even if you have this like smooth base measure, so here the base measure is going to be the distribution over topics. Okay, so a spike in this case is like a particular topic, a particular distribution over words. If I draw twice from the same Dirichlet process, I'm going to get two different collections of spikes. They will not have any overlapping sort of spike locations. They will be non-overlapping with probability one, right? Because it's a countably finite collection of points. It is a countably infinite collection of points. All a bunch of little point masses drawn from this continuous density. This set of locations will be completely disjoint from this set of locations. So that means that the set of topics that this document talks about have nothing in common with the set of topics that this other document talks about. Yep? Sorry, so this bell curve is a cartoon of the base measure of H, and then these blue lines are like the G that is drawn from a Dirichlet process with that H. No. The locations of there's an infinite number of spikes, and their locations are drawn from H, and their heights are drawn from this like stick breaking process.
Okay, so it's just for the locations.
Yes. Yeah. So the blue things are a random measure. They're a random distribution that's very spiky. Its mean is the red curve. The random measure is the red curve. Okay, it doesn't look like the densities that we're sort of drawing this representation don't reveal that the red thing would be the mean of the blue things, because the blue things don't have a density. But if we were to take little sets of the x-axis here and look at how big they were, like what their measure was, then the red curve, the idea is that the red curve gives us a measure that is the expectation of the measures we get from the blue spikes. That we put enough blue spikes of the right size on average into a particular chunk that they would be the same as the red measure on average. So red here is the H, and then the blue spikes are the G. Okay, the thing that is drawn from the Dirichlet process. And is, yep? There are more of them, in some sense, in the middle of the red curve, because their locations, the locations of the spikes are drawn according to the red curve. And then the sort of the weights of them are drawn from like the stick breaking process. Okay, so there's two things. There's locations of them, IID from the red curve, and then the sort of how big the spike is. They're delta functions, so talking about how high it is not a sensible thing, right? But we kind of like to represent them that way. Think about how big the delta function is. It's not like how much mass does it have. And that's what's drawn from the stick breaking process. Okay, so like the measure of a particular chunk, right, of this is saying, you know, in that region, what's the sum of all the stick weights that landed in that area? And that's how we get a random measure from these guys. Okay, but the point is that because we're throwing down these spikes, if I wanted to use this to form something like a topic model, like latent Dirichlet allocation, we would get none of the locations of the spikes here would be in the same locations as the spikes here. Okay? So as a result, we need something that's a little bit fancier, and this thing that's fancier is called a hierarchical Dirichlet process, or HDP. So the idea is to have all of the documents, Dirichlet process, its base measure, its H, is a draw from another Dirichlet process. Okay, the reason that fixes the problem is because since this thing that's sort of sitting up top, so rather than these two guys each being independently drawn from a Dirichlet process, they're drawn from a Dirichlet process random measure, that guy goes from continuous density to an atomic density, and then when you draw the sort of sub-Dirichlet process distributed measures from those guys, their H is discrete now. So they have a positive probability of having the same set of supports. Okay? So it's kind of a weird thing. So I'm going to say this again. So, in fact, let's draw some pictures. So if we have a continuous density, right, for our H, then what's happening is the way you can think about what we're drawing here. So this is an H. The first thing that we do is we throw down a bunch of points that are drawn from H, okay? And then we assign those. There's an infinite number of these points. We just spam out these points from H. Then they all have delta functions sitting on top of them. Okay? And the sort of the weights associated with those delta functions sum to 1, and their weights are what's drawn from the stick breaking process. Okay? So locations are drawn from H, and then the heights are drawn from this G, like GM distribution, that stick breaking process. Okay? So this is kind of like how we get those blue lines, and now you can see kind of why this measure might have H as its mean. Okay? Now the problem is that if we separately came along, if we use this as the foundation for a topic model, then the set of topics that are represented here will be completely disjoint from a set that if we did this process again. These guys would have no spike would land in the same place on both these guys. So it's like an event of probability 0. Okay, so the idea with the HDP is to do it this way. It's to say first, we have this H sitting up top that's smooth, okay? And now we draw another guy that we call G naught. Whoa, what happened? Okay, well, anyway, so there's an H up top, right? Nope. And so we get the spiky thing that is, and now the spiky thing is shared. Oh, there it is. All right. Okay, so this H, right, that is our sort of like set of all, that is a density over all possible topics in this case. And then we draw from that a G naught. And then for every one of our documents, we treat G naught as its base measure, and any spikes it throws down have to have support under G naught, okay? Because their locations have to be distributed according to G naught. So what that means is that they will have all different heights, but the locations will be a common countably infinite set. So you have positive probability of two different documents now talking about the same thing, which is something we really need. Yep?
So do they still, what that support would be, or do they still have probability based on the density of H, or what's the probability of
H? Yeah, so good question. So now the mean of this guy is G naught, right? But so essentially there will sort of be now even noisier versions of H, but with the property that each of these will share support. So this is basically a trick to add this atomic density inside the sort of Bayesian hierarchical model so that everybody can be talking about the same thing rather than talking about different things with probability 1. Okay. Other questions? Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So those pictures I showed, the question is, can you have a uniform H? Those pictures I showed earlier with the red bars where I was dividing things up, those had a uniform H on like that on that unit interval. So H is your prior. We're drawing it as Gaussians because kind of Gaussians we understand. But in the topic model, it's like a much more complicated thing, right? It's this like distribution over distributions in the vocabulary, right? It's some like pretty complicated object. So the great question. So the question is, why use a Dirichlet process for G naught instead of any other random measure that produced an atomic set? You could just we like the DP because it's conjugate, and I probably doesn't feel like it right now, but it's like easy in some sense, because it's conjugate to these observations. And it has this like Chinese restaurant process sort of interpretation for doing the sampling, stick breaking. Like it has there's a lot of representational advantages to using a Dirichlet process specifically. And in fact, it turns out that in this nested setting, you get this thing that sort of eye-rollingly is called the Chinese restaurant franchise, in which basically now what happens is, you know, when you sit at a table, that table then makes a draw from a kind of a nested, you know, goes up to the like local franchise boss to decide like what, you know, what's going to be at that table. So the point is that, you know, these guys make like a local decision, and then each of those locations is drawn from this higher level object. So that's part of the reason we like a DP for G naught. Okay, so the other reason we like this is because it informs things like hidden Markov models. So hidden Markov models, as we said earlier, is another example where you have to choose the size of the latent state space, and that's going to heavily inform like the capacity of the model. You'd like to maybe instead talk about an infinitely large hidden Markov model with a potentially very, very large number of states. So remember that the way the hidden Markov model works is that you have this Markov transition matrix where every row essentially is a distribution over next possible states, right? If that was a draw from a Dirichlet process, which you'd kind of would be the natural thing to do, then you would never transition back to the same to a state you had seen before, right? It would because it would assign zero probability to all of those guys, right? So this is kind of like the sets don't intersect property coming up again. Hierarchical Dirichlet process allows you to do this essentially by saying now that all of those states draw from some overall base measure that is itself atomic, and this is the set of states that you might actually kind of realistically visit. It's still infinite, but now you have positive probability to all of these previous guys. So it has this kind of setup, which is just a small number of kind of additional variables in your graphical model, basically saying that when I draw the rows of that Markov transition matrix, they need to share structure. They need to share the same kind of possible set of next states to go. What this means, you have an infinite number of states, and then there's some number that are sort of like very likely, and you spend most of your time orbiting in those high probability states with some non-zero probability of like of taking an excursion into some set of lower probability states if the data warrant it. Okay, so this is taking advantage of this kind of GEM distribution representation explicitly, just saying that you have this infinitely large Markov transition matrix where the sort of the probabilities are very rapidly decreasing. Okay, so let's talk about, that's kind of the main kind of extension to the Dirichlet process that people use for actual modeling, things like HMMs, like to give an example of this HMM. So I collaborate with some neuroscientists, and what we're trying to, one of the things we're trying to do is build a quantitative model for mouse behavior. So we'd like to be able to do unsupervised learning to understand the dynamics of a mouse freely behaving. And this sounds like kind of a weird problem, but essentially if you want to understand the like genetic and neural correlates of, you know, of mouse behavior in order to inform some disease or to sort of come up with a new drug or something, then essentially you have grad students labeling video, right? You have, you know, if you're really like advanced, you record a bunch of video and then the grad students label every frame, and you try to then characterize somehow quantitatively what the mouse is doing. In And this is bad, right, because it requires that the grad students like see the same thing in the mouse when they look at it sort of twice. And it also requires human labels that are very anthropocentric for describing what the mouse is doing. And it requires somehow like the mouse operating on a human recognizable timescale. And so as a result, none of these things are really satisfied. And the inter-observer error rate for people trying to study quantitative behavior in something like, you know, freely behaving mice is like 70%. Like people just don't agree on what the mouse is doing. And so it's almost impossible to do sort of really good science and really good neuroscience and genetics in terms of like actual free, you know, free behaving sort of like real life situations versus very, very sort of narrow constructed examples. And so we've been developing this model with like a 3D depth camera and kind of essentially to try to actually segment out mouse behavior in a way that isn't anthropocentric. And it's very appealing to use a Bayesian nonparametric model here, exactly like this kind of HMM. I mean, a little more complicated, but the precisely because we don't sort of have to commit ourselves to a certain kind of set of behaviors that the mouse might be doing. And if we see some new mouse, it might be doing something completely novel and we can handle that coherently. Okay, so these are models that, you know, that we actually like because they allow us to explore spaces that are like completely new. So there's a few different variations to sort of be aware of. We're not going to go into detail, but the one of the things that you probably noticed when we were looking at those curves for the Chinese restaurant process is that you sort of had this logarithmic number of tables that got that, you know, sort of new clusters that we could introduce as you added data. But some kinds of data, like in particular, like natural language and sort of natural scenes and things, tend to have power law type behavior. And so there's a so-called two-parameter Chinese restaurant process that adds an additional discount parameter into the sort of the update rule. So instead of just this proportion, it's minus this discount parameter. And what this basically does is it induces you to want to sit at new tables with a little bit higher probability. And so as a result, you tend to get more tables from the same number of people, and those tables tend to have fewer people sitting at them. And the underlying kind of random measure is something called the Pittman-Yore process. So we won't go into too much detail, but it's kind of like a generalization of the Dirichlet process, so that rather than, whereas this might be the kind of tables you would get from a vanilla CRP, if you turn this knob, this discount parameter knob, then you'll tend to sort of have potentially quite a lot, sort of a larger number of tables for the same number of people. So this is motivated by things like, figures like this that look at sort of word frequency as a function of vocabulary and kind of the sort of power laws associated with it. When we talk about big discrete distributions, then the Pittman-Yore seems like a better fit to the natural statistics of language, at least English. Same kind of thing has been studied in computer vision, where people are looking at kind of how many distinct objects are represented in a scene. Again, this seems to have kind of power law type behavior. So we like these kind of Pittman-Yore extensions for nonparametric models where rather than just having this kind of one knob, now we have two knobs, to sort of balance sort of number of objects we find, but also kind of that tail, like how does it grow? There's another cool object called a polya tree. So I showed you this figure before where I sort of started with, where I basically took the unit interval, and what I'm doing is kind of making a binary tree where I chop every one of these little bars into two smaller bars and then allocate its mass randomly. Okay, so I was telling you that we can produce this kind of figure based on this nice kind of like marginalization properties where we can do the split according to a beta distribution to get sort of this spiky Dirichlet process type sample. So it turns out that that there's kind of a whole family of such partitioning schemes called polya trees, where this choice of chopping it up according to this beta distribution, which is only one possible choice, and it gives you the Dirichlet process. But there exist other choices you could make for this kind of partitioning with beta variates that actually produce continuous densities with probability one, which is something that we might like because the Dirichlet process, even though it's cool, like, you know, we really actually want continuous densities often. And so what this basically does is it kind of makes much less aggressive splittings. And so you tend to get sort of better behaved densities. I have never seen anyone use this model for anything in practice, but it's kind of cool. there's other kind of interesting ideas in this space. One thing is called the Dirichlet diffusion tree. So this is also a way to sort of reparameterize, come up with an object in which the Dirichlet process is a special case. So the idea here is that you're basically, you start with a point and you have this kind of time that you're adding to things. So this is like a one-dimensional density that we're going to produce by diffusing a point in time left to right here until it lands at some spot. And then future data in a Chinese restaurant kind of way are going to follow the diffusion of previous points according to its popularity, but with some probability they might jump off and diffuse all by themselves. And the kind of the path that future ones take depends on how popular the path was of the previous one. And you can parameterize this sort of jumping off probability in different ways. One of them recovers the Dirichlet process, much like the Poilu tree can recover the Dirichlet process. And then there are other kind of hazard functions for this jumping off thing that cause you to get continuous densities with probability one. And basically it boils down to, are you definitely going to jump off sometime before you hit the end? So this is by the incomparable Radford Neil. You can also, there's also variants of this that rather than just have sort of bifurcations, can do multifurcations and heavy tail pit manure type things and so on. Just something to be aware of. Another example of a model that is super cool, but I've never seen anybody actually use. Radford Neil has the only implementation of it that I know of. Neil, have you ever implemented the Dirichlet diffusion tree?
No, but it's all that competition, the prediction competition.
Yeah, that's right. When he invented it, right? Another thing to sort of be aware of that people do use a bit of is something called a nested Chinese restaurant process. So this is the idea is that after the customers sit at their table, then the next day they come back to they basically, the story is, this is, as I said, it's kind of eye-rolly stuff, but like at the table you're sitting at one night, there's a card that tells you the restaurant you should go to the next night, and then you And so then you have this tree structured thing where you go to different restaurants depending on what table you were at, and then those restaurants have their own tables. And so now customers wind up being paths down this infinite tree. Okay, and so the point would be that now instead of just partitions, you have nested partitions. That's the name of the game here. And that could be a useful thing both in of itself, but also for things like topic models, that you'd like to have nested structure. So rather than now a particular topic just being a sort of a simple distribution of words, they could maybe be variants on higher level topics. Okay, and so then you can maybe get a little bit more interpretability, a little bit more structure than you would get from sort of a vanilla flat topic model. Another little bit of work that I did a couple years ago was trying to take another way to tackle trees, which is to what we call a tree-structured stick-breaking process, where rather than the sort of vanilla stick-breaking process that's sort of just going left to right, the idea is to interleave two stick-breaking processes so that you break off a chunk and then also can branch with different probabilities, getting an infinite tree, but with the property that when you use it for clustering, then the data can live inside the tree. So rather than the nested Chinese restaurant process where data are infinite paths, then here the data are sort of finite paths. And this has some kind of nice inductive bias for some kinds of problems. And gives you kind of cool exchangeable distributions over trees. So that brings us to talking about exchangeability, which is kind of one of the really key things sitting beneath this and also other kind of nonparametric ideas and including the Gaussian process. So the key intuition is kind of to think about what should matter, you know, given some set of data, and we want to do some modeling, you know, what matters about the data and what doesn't. And in particular, you know, if I knew in advance that I was going to get queried at some particular location, given the data, should that change anything about the way I model the data? Or more generally, if I knew I was going to get queried at, you know, about five different locations at some future time, should that change the way I should build my model at all? Or if I took two of these blue guys, you know, so there's some latent indexing, right? They came in some order on our file system. If I flip those guys, Should that change the way that I model things just because I you know, reordered the data? If I have a set of documents that's like, you know, that I want to model with the topic model or something, should it matter if I like, you know, used a different naming scheme for the files and then they got loaded into my memory in a different way? Should that matter? The idea of exchangeability is that these kinds of things shouldn't matter, right? That we should be able to be invariant to the particular way that we happen to get our data. And that not all models that we care about, and in particular not all sort of Bayesian nonparametric models necessarily would have such properties. But the interesting ones do, and they allow us to do this kind of like infinite dimensional model on my finite computer, right? So for example, we can define this kind of idea of projectivity, which is the idea that there can be sort of a very large set of data, but I can reason about a finite set of it coherently, right? So for example, let's imagine we have a set S. Row is going to be a partition of the kind we would get from like a Chinese restaurant process. We can think about a projection onto a subset of S, S prime, as basically being, you know, we have this partition, so it's a bunch of disjoint subsets. We're just going to remove from those subsets all of the points that are not in S prime. And this essentially gives us a way to sort of go from some larger set down to a restriction, right, while preserving the same partition structure. I think there's an extra square bracket in there. So we can now think about then sequences of distributions over partitions of different sizes. So let's imagine that we have, so here I'm using these square brackets to indicate sets up to size like n. And we can imagine distributions over these sets of different, over partitions of these sets of different sizes. And the idea of sort of having a consistent sort of projection here is that when I have a large set, if I have a distribution over a large set, and then I project it down to a smaller set, and then I ask within this sequence of distributions, what's the resulting marginal over the smaller set? It needs to be the same. So why does this matter? So if I have a model for data, and I apply that model to 100 data, okay, and I do some fitting, and then I marginalize out 10 of those data, okay, it should give me the same answer as if I had just gotten the 90 data to begin with. Okay, and then that needs to be true for partitions, density models, Gaussian processes, kind of no matter what we care about. This is like a totally, I mean, honestly, intuitive appealing property, right? That my answer shouldn't change whether I'm marginalizing something out or whether I just didn't get it to begin with. Right, and that's what we're getting at with the sequence of distributions over partitions. And it turns out that the Chinese restaurant process satisfies this property, which I was kind of hinting at earlier by the idea that the distribution over partitions that you get from the CRP doesn't depend on the actual identities of the indices. It only depends on the sizes of the clusters. Right, and that's exactly what this kind of projectivity property is about. And the two-parameter extension has it as well. So, sort of a very, very related idea that, I mean, it's almost the same thing, but it's not quite as the idea. So is this idea of exchangeability, which is essentially that the distribution that I get over the data, again, doesn't depend on, I could permute the data in an arbitrary way, or the indices in an arbitrary way, and I would get the same model. Okay? And you can see, again, re-examining this exchangeable, distribution over partitions for the CRP, that it's going to have this property because the indices of the data themselves don't appear. It's the size of the clusters and the total number of clusters and the sort of the total number of data, right? That we don't have to ever worry about inspecting individual data to understand the way that they would partition according to the CRP. So this is nice, right? This is basically saying that if I like, you know, happen to sort my data in my directory in a different way, it shouldn't give me a different answer, right? So this is a property that we like. And it's related to the idea of infinite exchangeability, which is that this should be true essentially for any n. That no matter how, I should have a model like over partitions, and if I have this consistent, distribution over partitions, that sort of no matter how big that set is, if I project it down, I'll still get the same answer. All right, again, this is the idea that sort of getting back to the stuff we looked at earlier, it's the idea that the data I'm going to look at later shouldn't change the way I think about what I'm doing now. That if I tell you in advance that you're going to be tested on 10 data sometime later, that shouldn't change what you think about the 100 data that you're trying to study right now. Okay, that there's nothing peculiar about the data that you happen to have. So we can marginalize away. So this comes up, for example, in the Gaussian process, the idea that if I have a 100-dimensional Gaussian distribution, I can compute its marginal distribution on only 25 points in a completely consistent way. Okay, that no matter how I arrive at this 25 points, I'll get the same answer. So from a Bayesian point of view, this is a very appealing thing because it allows us to invoke this idea of DeFinetti's theorem, which is essentially that infinitely exchangeable sequences are going to be a mixture over IID variables with some unknown sort of latent parameter G. This latent parameter is unique, and we call it the DeFinetti measure. And so kind of getting back to some conversations we had during the break, so the relationship, for example, between the Dirichlet process and the Chinese restaurant process can be understood in that the Dirichlet process is the DeFinetti measure of the Chinese restaurant process. Okay, the Chinese restaurant process is this exchangeable distribution over partitions. The underlying mixing measure is this Dirichlet process. So we like this a lot, precisely because of this, the fact that it means that the models that we build and the way we understand them doesn't depend on the particular ordering of the data. We don't have to sort of explicitly impute data that we didn't see. We can just marginalize it away. And that, as I said, there's kind of nothing special about the data that we happen to have, and that we get the same answer integrating out kind of future data. I should just point out that it's not always desirable to have infinite exchangeability. Sometimes, you know, the documents say that you want a model really come from a particular time or a location or have some covariates that you care about, and then they aren't exchangeable. And so it's not something we always want, but in the cases where such covariates don't exist, it's something we really like because it's saying basically that the kind of our indexing scheme that it doesn't matter. Something comes up a lot in Bayesian statistics because it sort of says that that we can do very complicated things if we can reason about that. Well, it kind of allows us to come up with a very general notion of invariance. Exchangeability in the context of something like CRP is one particular kind of invariance, but graphs and other kinds of relational data, we could imagine having different notions of invariance. And the point of DeFinetti's theorem is that we can still reason about them using this kind of like underlying mixing measure. So I want to switch gears a little bit to now tell you about sort of a different idea that also satisfies some of these properties that's a little bit newer, called the endian buffet process. So clusters, we can think of clusters as being, you know, like we get from a Dirichlet process, as being a particular way to get binary matrices, right? The idea is that we could have properties that are like what cluster do you belong to as being columns, and we could have our data items being rows in this matrix, and a cluster model says that every datum is of one particular type and only one particular type. You are a cat or you're a dog, and there's not two kinds, or you can't be two things at once, right? But that's a really restricting kind of assumption about modeling, when in practice things don't necessarily belong to single types. They have a lot of different possible types. And that motivates the idea of something called a latent feature model, where rather than you being a cat or a dog, it could be like, do you have a tail? Do you have a nose? How many legs? You know, it could be different properties, and you could have one or more of these properties or none of them. And so instead of a matrix in which we have exactly one sort of entry that's non-negative, or so that's non-zero, we instead could have some collection of properties that are all simultaneously on for each of the data. So rather than a cluster, latent cluster model, a latent feature model where you could have a lot of different kinds of features. And the endian buffet process is the kind of the generalization in a sense. It's kind of the Dirichlet process is about clustering. The endian buffet process is a much newer object that is about trying to come up with latent feature models for data. So it kind of works like this in the finite case. So we could imagine that what we're going to do is represent one of these matrices explicitly. Every row is one of our data, and it's going to have k columns that are these different features that the data could have. And the entry, and for the nth row, the kth entry is going to be 1 if it has that feature and 0 otherwise. What we could say is that each of these entries in the matrix is a Bernoulli variable that has, where the column has a particular probability of it being one. Okay, so all of them have the same probability of being one in the whole column. And we could put a beta prior on that. And kind of like before, we could put a penalty for this beta prior depending on how many rows we're going to have. Okay, so the probability of it being one goes down with more columns in the matrix. This has an expected value we can compute just from the beta distribution. And it has the interesting property that as we take k to infinity, we wind up with a finite number of expected non-zero entries in this big matrix. Okay, so that's kind of cool, right? Because it basically means that we can kind of think about this limit and it won't force us, so we can have an infinite number of possible features without forcing every sort of object to have an infinite, you know, use an infinite number of them. That is, you can have a finite number of latent features even if there are an infinite number of them available to you. So the Indium Buffet process is a kind of formalism of this that has a story kind of like the Chinese restaurant process. So now the story is that in London there are these Indian restaurants that seem like they have an infinite number of dishes, and so the question is kind of what of these dishes do I taste by putting on my plate? And the way that Indian buffet process works is that, for example, you might start with this first, so this is like the first customer. The first customer tries the first Poisson alpha number of these dishes. So draws a Poisson random variable and tastes that many dishes. Okay, so just the first K, you know, whatever dishes. Okay, then the second customer comes in and they're gonna make decisions about what they're gonna taste based on the popularity with prior customers. Okay, so what fraction of prior customers tried this dish? And they will try it with that probability. And then after they've tried all of the dishes or have made a decision about whether or not to try all of the dishes that previous customers have tried, they then try a few completely novel dishes. They'll try now sort of the nth customer tries Poisson alpha over n additional dishes. Okay, so you can see how this works here. These are customers in the rows, the dishes are the columns, and the first customer tries all of those dishes and sits down. Second customer comes in and is basically sort of flipping a 50-50 coin whether or not to try each of these, tries a few, and then adds three more of their own. Next customer comes in, looks to see sort of which of these were most popular with the previous two people, tries some of them and a couple of novel dishes, and this process continues. So this has a rich get richer property column-wise now. So rather than I sit at the lunch table that is most popular, I'm trying these dishes. I'm allocating features according to which features tend to be pretty common in the data and possibly having some completely unique features. Okay, so it's a similar kind of idea, but now I get this binary vector that doesn't necessarily have to have only one entry, but can have a collection of entries. So it's random sparse binary matrices. And you can see this can be unbounded, right? This could sort of just keep going off and off and off, and it would almost all be zeros, but I could allocate sort of an arbitrary new set of latent features. So this was proposed, I guess, almost 10 years ago now, and it has some nice, interesting properties. It's exchangeable in the rows. That is, that the sort of the distribution over what features tend to be on doesn't depend on sort of when you come into the restaurant. The expected number of total entries is determined by alpha. So this is basically like telling you what the sparsity is of the matrix that you get. And the number of non-zero columns grows almost exactly like the way that the Chinese restaurant process, number of tables grows, sort of logarithmically in n. So these are matrices drawn from this process with different alphas. So you can see that larger alpha results in people trying more dishes and having tasted more dishes marginally. There's also a two-parameter generalization that allows you to separate out the sort of number of dishes that people taste from the amount of sharing that's going on. So this is kind of appealing because it gives you an additional knob to sort of separate out these two things. So all three of these are using alpha equals 10, but they have different sort of second parameters to determine how. So this has a ton of sharing. So everybody still has sort of Poisson alpha number of things they've tasted, but they tend to overlap massively versus this has the same sort of marginal row statistics, but there's very little sharing going on. So there's some nice things going on with the IBP. So it it has a stick breaking construction that is really interestingly sort of a kind of complement to the Dirichlet process. It has an underlying Diffinetti measure that is the beta process. There's some different inference approaches out there, the usual sort of suspects like Gibbs sampling and slice sampling and so on. There's some variational approaches and particle filtering approaches that have also been proposed. It's a little bit hairier to work with than the Dirichlet process. It has kind of more stuff going on. People have used it for a variety of different kinds of things. I've used it and some other folks have used it, for example, to come up with random graph structures. And people have done kinds of, you know, used it for matrix factorization models, for collaborative filtering, sparse latent factor models, sparse topic models, where each, you know, you get trying a dish corresponds to a document having a, talking about a particular topic. And we've also used it for learning with ontological data and quite a few different things. It has a kind of a very nice flavor that I think makes it unique. Like, there's lots of different ways you can imagine doing clustering. There's been a lot of different proposals. You know, the Dirichlet process is nice and elegant, but it maybe it's not really obviously unique, whereas the Indian Buffet process is actually kind of a very novel modeling scheme that I think sort of people hadn't really tackled so much. Like, the idea that you have a collection of these kind of potential latent properties and that some of these are more popular than others. Okay, so I thought I'd sort of wrap up a little bit here. So there's a lot of Bayesian nonparametrics that I didn't mention. We focus mostly on the Dirichlet process and friends. Obviously, there's Gaussian processes that Neil talked a lot about that are sort of intimately related. Really cool new ideas for thinking about these sort of same Diffinetti ideas, but applying them to things like graphs and networks, something called an Aldous-Hoover representation. Related to these are nonparametric relational models to understand, say, things like you know, the way that the sort of different objects interact in the sort of collaborative filtering type setting. New ideas called like the negative binomial process, where you get something like an IBP but with counts. Ideas like completely random measures, where you get a random measure but it doesn't necessarily integrate to one. Dependent random measures, where you can have a Dirichlet process, like a mixture model, say varying as a function of time or space. There's a lot of theoretical work on understanding consistency of Bayesian nonparametrics. So this is like, when does the estimator that you get from one of these models, when is that going to converge to the truth? So when are things going to be dense in model space, like I mentioned earlier? There's a ton of things that I sort of associate with Bayesian nonparametrics, you know, in the space of point processes. So determinants of point processes, Hawkes processes, Minterm processes, and so on. And of course, nonparametrics is not only Bayesian. There's also, you know, non-Bayesian nonparametrics, which we didn't talk about at all today. So, you know, the big picture here, and my voice is now going, so I apologize. You know, the big picture here is that when we do Bayesian modeling, it's all about joint distributions. Nonparametrics gives us a very flexible way to specify these and allow the capacity and complexity of these joint distributions to grow with data. And the key property is that we can marginalize away a potentially infinite number of random variables if they have these kind of nice projectivity properties that Gaussian processes, Dirichlet processes, and Indian Buffet processes all have. And the point really is, these models allow you to deal with infinite dimensional objects, but projections allow you to deal with them on your actual sort of finite computer. And this is a very powerful thing to be able to do. There are lots of processes. We talked about a few, and they are sort of models for different kinds of things. So here's a kind of a cheat sheet of just like a few. We talked about GPs and DPs and CRPs and Pitman-Yor and IBPs, HDPs. So that gets us down to here. Poisson processes are, of course, like a classic object for thinking about random point sets. And there are variations on Poisson processes like determinantal point processes and Hawkes processes if you want more complicated interactions. And then I mentioned sort of things like completely random measures, which turn out to be sort of ways to derive some of these other objects in different kinds of like normalizations and so on. I showed this slide earlier, but there's a lot of resources out there for learning about these things, great tutorials online, and sort of interesting review papers and a relatively recent book. And thank you all for listening. We have a few minutes for questions, if you have any. I'm sure you have tons, but so fire away. Yes. Yeah, so all of these kinds of, so both the Dirichlet process and the Indian Buffet process can be thought of as ways to do dimensionality reduction. Because what you're doing is summarizing the data in terms of a small number of latent properties. So with the Dirichlet process, we're saying that I'm gonna summarize this datum with its cluster membership. And I'm gonna replace complicated high dimensional object with an integer. The Indian Buffet process says I'm gonna summarize this possibly high dimensional object with a small, potentially binary vector instead of an integer.
Does the Gaussian process have the Gaussian process like models that are for the initial reduction? What's the difference? What's the problem of using the Dirichlet aspect of the Gaussian process?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the question is, like, how does like the Gaussian process latent variable model relate to this kind of dimensionality reduction? So the GPLVM, and we have like the expert on GPLVM sitting here, so. But the, so the GPLVM, right, is taking a continuously valued high dimensional data and trying to summarize it with a small number of continuous, you know, low dimensional variables, satisfying the property that you could explain the entire set of high dimensional data in terms of a smooth function from the low dimensional to the high dimensional space. And essentially what this is kind of trying to do is discover whether or not there's a low-dimensional manifold that's possibly very nonlinear living there. These are not really trying, IBPs and DPs are not really trying to discover manifolds. They're trying to discover, like a DP is trying to discover a group, like a discrete integer that can summarize the data and not a sort of a manifold. And the IBP is trying to discover a small number of features, a small number of discrete features that can, you know, that characterize the data, but again, not really like a smooth manifold as such. Any other questions?
Right.
Yep.
Can you talk a little bit about complexity of inference?
Oh. Sure, yeah, so complexity of inference. So, you know, the complexity of inference for these things, strictly speaking, is enormous because you can, it's clear that, for example, fitting a Dirichlet process mixture model must be at least as hard as like doing EM in a finite mixture model. And we know that that's like NP hard. And so the strict complexity of finding the sort of the best configuration or counting good configurations is going to be in some hideous complexity class. The sort of practical complexity of like running MCMC on one of these things is sort of like, it's gonna be something like cubic in dimension and roughly linear in the number of data. But it kind of, it's something like that. So you're making multiple passes over all the data, trying to decide like whether to assign them to different clusters and then taking each of those and then updating each of them separately. And typically fitting the clusters will be something like cubic in dimension. No, so there's variational schemes, sequential Monte Carlo, and what else is there? I guess those are the sort of the three main ideas. So MCMC is nice because it's kind of easy to set up in some sense, and it takes advantage of almost all these representations. But I think people have had quite a lot of success with the variational setup as well. Yeah, so that's a really good point. So in practice, you know, most of the time when people do variational inference, they do some kind of, truncation. So you just basically say, you know, for example, like, you know, I have 1,000 data, I'm gonna run my stick breaking process out to 10,000 sticks and call it a day, and I never have to look deeper than that, you know, because the probability that I'll need to use those tiny, tiny little sticks is vanishingly small. And this kind of idea where I'm just gonna use a large finite model that kind of has the same distribution over that, you know, over the finite set, is we kind of call that like the weak limit. It's kind of like basically taking, you know, when in the the sort of species analogy in the very beginning, where I said, let's just take a huge K and kind of see what algorithm we get. So that's something that people, you know, that is kind of a reasonable way to set up something like a variational algorithm. It's just to say, actually, I'm just going to use a very large number and have the inductive bias be the same as what it would be for the nonparametric model, and it'll just be a truncation and saves me the work of actually, like, having, you know, having to sort of get all the tiny little epsilons right. Yep. What's the expectation? What's the expectation of the? Yeah. Oh, what's the expectation of the size of the tables? Like, or the, sorry. It's going to be the, I think it's going to be the same as it would be in the CRP, because you just basically have this additional kind of weird base measure. So I think when you integrate out that higher base measure, you wind up with the same statistics. But I'm not completely certain of that. There's this funny thing, because in the HTP, where you can, because it's an atomic measure, the lower level things can draw the same things at the higher level multiple times because they have positive probability, whereas that can't happen in the vanilla DP. So you have to do some more bookkeeping in the HTP than you otherwise would. Yeah. Do we do some what of the hyperparameters? Yeah. Let me paraphrase. So can you do some kind of initial estimation of the hyperparameters of the model in order to improve mixing? Yeah, I mean, I can believe that. I mean, in my experience, the difficulty in mixing of like a Dirichlet processed mixture has a lot to do with sort of chopping up groups, right? That in practice, there's often a lot of non-identifiability. There's a lot of sort of different ways that you could cluster any given data set. And it can be very hard to, if you get stuck in one kind of configuration where you've coupled two groups together that should really be split apart, it can be very difficult to escape that kind of thing. I would say that my experience hasn't been the hyperparameters have been the limiting factor. That, so on the other hand, for Gaussian processes, I would say that hyperparameters are the hard part, much more so than they are for DPs. That for example, if you have like a Gaussian process like classifier and it has some hyperparameters, you need to integrate out all of these functions and you can't do it analytically, and that's a much bigger challenge. Whereas I think that's not so much the hard part in like the DP and the IBP. Okay, thank you.